Hi everyone, Teddy Baldessar here. Now, whenever dealing with a niche environment in terms of a interest, whether it's watches, cars, music, there are going to be gatekeepers and ultimately snobs that are going to put newcomers down as well as people just down that aren't to their standard. And I hate the idea that this is going on in watches. I think we should always just welcome people in because somebody who's buying, say, a more affordable watch is eventually maybe going to buy more and more, and they are very much the same in part of this hobby as anybody else. But today what we're going to be doing is offering up some firepower back to the snobs, looking at some relatively affordable watches that still get the thumbs up even from the worst of the worst crowd of the snobs. And again, I am not saying that it's a good idea to appeal to snobs. I don't think that's what this is about at all, but just giving you the watches that from a outsider perspective, maybe you're just getting into watches that even the biggest snob out there is gonna have a hard time hating, which I think would be fun. So in this video, I am going to be looking at quite a few different watches. I'm not gonna be able to mention every single reference, but trying to keep it general where I can, as well as jumping into specific models when appropriate, when there's very specific use cases when it actually applies to fitting the mold here. Also, going to be looking at mostly more popular watches, just given that in order to be widely accepted, it also, of course, needs to be widely known. And also, we're going to keep this to under $1,000 in terms of price, because I think for the world of watches, that is seen very much as entry level in many ways, but still, some fantastic watches in this range, so we're going to be looking at some great ones here today. Also, cool announcement, we did just become an authorized dealer of Citizen watches, which we'll certainly mention in this video because there is a good example of watches that will apply here. But head over to teddybaldessar.com. We have quite a bit of different options available, mostly from the ProMaster collection, also from the Chandler collection, as those are, I think, great options in terms of maybe more everyday with the Chandler watches, and then moving into their ProMasters with their Nighthawks as well as their ProMaster divers that, of course, are built for spec and do a very good job utilizing EcoDrive technology in many of their timepieces, which is their proprietary solar technology that allows to really set it and forget it, perhaps the best set it and forget it type of lifestyle with a watch. So check it out, teddybaldessar.com. Now to begin here, looking at the first watch, and this is perhaps the most obvious choice when looking in this direction, and that is just the Casio G-Shock. And we could just put this as any Casio, even like the entry-level Casio F91Ws. These certainly apply as well, but the G-Shock, in terms of its mass market appeal, as well as just respect from even the most seasoned collectors, very rarely do you see a watch in this price range that has just this mass acclaim and appreciation across all fronts. If you want to go for the more traditional DW5600, that really is the traditional architecture of a G-Shock and will be the most mass appealing, I think the most stylish as well if you are maybe leaning in that direction. But you get all the traditional perks that come with a G-Shock. The watch is of course made for robustness as well as just offering just great no-nonsense wear. And even the most seasoned collectors, people that are spending hundreds of thousands of dollars on their watch collection, chances are they still wear their G-Shock time and time again. And I know I am the same way. In specific environments, when you don't want to bang something up, the G-Shock always going to get some love. And I think there's nobody that's going to hate on a G-Shock, no matter where you are in your watch collecting journey. Now, number two is going to be looking at Vostok. Now, apart from just its cult-like following, in terms of where it falls in price, you're getting these under $100. You're getting in-house calibers. You're getting suitable water resistance. And typically, I'm finding many of these watches, in terms of regulation, you can get these things clocking in at incredible spec. And it's just a no-nonsense. You don't really care about anything else than just getting a nice mechanical watch for under $100 with dive watch capabilities. The Vostok Amphibia is probably the best choice in this range. You can also go for a Commanderski, but the Amphibia is probably the most common watch that you are going to see mentioned from Vostok, of course. And I think for good reason, there's really hard to hate these watches. Of course, they're not gonna be for everybody, but if somebody sees somebody with a Vostok on, you know that that's an enthusiast, you know that's somebody that cares about watches, because otherwise, there's not as much appeal to them. These are just strictly mechanical watches made at a very affordable price for enthusiast market, but also with some true cool history behind them being actually in-house made Russian timepieces. So now for number three, and honestly, 5 years ago, I don't know if you could actually mention this as being a no-brainer, but I think the brand has now been appreciated quite a bit more by even seasoned collectors and was a gateway for many people getting into watches, and that was Orient. Now, Orient, in terms of where they sit in the marketplace, incredibly attractive value for money. And the watch that probably gets mentioned the most, and of course is also going to be, I think, one that is going to garner up some respect as well, is the Orient Bambino. You could also mention the dive watches that they have in their entry tier, but I think what Orient does best that is so different than the rest of the offering, because there's a lot of affordable dive watches out there, there's not many people that will lean in to a dress watch in a variety of different versions and styles and do it this well. You have in-house calibers in these, you have a variety of different dial options to choose from with the now many versions that have been rolled out over the years. And when you're dealing with 150 to like 200 bucks in terms of prices on average, it's just really hard to beat these things. And I also find that from a parallel just standpoint, when comparing these to Seiko watches and the movements inside of them, say you put this up against a 7S26 with their in-house calibers here, I find the Orient is usually doing a better job of keeping better time, and of course, many of them featuring hacking as well, with being a very useful feature when looking in the direction. But watches that just look way more expensive and of course are probably the perfect gateway if you got 150 bucks to spend on a watch. Okay, now I'm just going to get this out of the way. Seiko, Seiko, Seiko. And I'm just going to break it up in three different parts because there are just so many collections within Seiko's catalog that you can mention. First, with their divers. And this applies to pretty much anything. Whether we're talking SKXs, which probably maybe are going to be the ultimate cult classic in terms of dive watches. Value for money now in 2021, not there. Looking at the Turtles though, the Samurais, Sumos, a variety of different options here. They're all basically the, I would say, best in class for dive watches under $1,000. I mean, you can't really do much better than Turtle. Of course, they're gonna be size prohibitive, but any watch guy or any watch girl is going to look at a dive watch from Seiko and is going to give it a thumbs up. No one's gonna hate on these things. And that's for good reason, because they are just simply great watches and compete with watches of multiples of the price. Also, going into another section with Seiko is going to be their cocktail times, their SARBs, and their SARCSs. Now, the cocktail times, we all know the dials and affiliation with actual famous cocktails and the rib-like finish on the dial surface. I think it's probably the best-looking dial that you're gonna find for around 400 bucks. Variety of different options to choose from, just given the actual influence and inspiration for these actual pieces. So, lot to choose from there. We're gonna be more toward the dress end. Then you have for the JDM models, which you can find from time to time with the SARB models. Now, the SARBs have started to go up in price across the board. When I was first getting into watches, you can get a SARB 033 for like 300 bucks, like 400 bucks. Very easy to find these things when they first were released. And that was a no-brainer for many people. I see these now trading for way more than that now. And I don't think the value is still there, but still mass appealing. Also will cover you in every scenario and gets a lot of respect. Then you also have other JDM models with the SARCSs. These are also great options too. I own a SARCS 045 and it is personally still one of my favorite Seiko watches still to this day. Love the way it looks. All the different SARCSs you have to choose from. You can go a little bit higher end with the SARCS 055, 033, 035. There's a lot out there when you get into Seiko JDMs, and this basically right here is kind of these hybridized watches that are a little more dressy, but also could fit the bill in some other areas of casual wear. Just want to take all of these in here and lump them together. And then finally, we also have Seiko 5s, which I don't think I need to go into detail why Seiko 5s are so beloved. Very much the same elements that I mentioned in regards to the Orient Bambino are here, but then just take the amount of options that I mentioned there, which there are an abundance of, and then multiply that by like 100, because there are so many Seiko 5s out there. You have old JDM models, models that have just been in production for quite a bit of time. You also could look at the new Seiko 5 sports models that have come out, which I think Seiko is now kind of really doing a very nice job in regards to this and kind of hitting their stride of the new Seiko 5 and what it's now is and reimagined in 2020, 2021. So these are all great, fantastic entry-level options for mechanical watch perspective. All right, so now for Switzerland, looking at probably the most entry-level tier that you're gonna find with Swatch. And Swatch, since the 1980s, has kind of been this beloved brand by even high-end collectors, collecting the different styles, a bit more eclectic and playful in terms of what they're going for with designs. And now with the System 51, a bit more of a kind of disposable throwaway movement that will last for some time, but not meant to really be a traditional Swiss timepiece, but still has so much appeal and fun in its actual just ethos behind the Swatch design and what it's just kind of been for so long. In regards to the System 51, it is going to be a bit larger, going to of course have a variety of different dial options to choose from and styles to go for, but these are truly beloved amongst collectors as well as people just getting into it. They're fun, they're youthful, and I love how Swatch has almost been just unchanged since they've come onto the scene. And from a historical perspective in watchmaking, these are significant timepieces. When you're talking about Swatch, they really did save the world of Swiss watchmaking in general and allowing it to counteract that quartz crisis. So a lot of history here and a lot of respect, even from the highest end collectors. Now moving back to Japan with, I would say, again, one of the most popular brands out there on the market with Citizen. So Citizen, let's be frank, they're kind of a mixed bag compared to Seiko. Seiko is a bit more of an enthusiast brand and I think does a better job with catering to that crowd. Citizen hits it on two fronts. You have the stuff that's probably not best suited for, of course, high-end collectors that won't really get any appreciation. So I kind of call these like the mall watch Citizen watches. And I think you'll know what I'm talking about if you ever just walk into a Dillard's or anything of that sort. But then on the other side, you also have their ProMaster collection, which are made to really embody, I think, the general just perspective that someone who is into watches would value. Their dive watches are some of the best value for money. You also have the Navihawk, the Nighthawk, that are part of the ProMaster collection that also have a lot of fandom around it. And it kind of hits it on all fronts in terms of what the ProMaster collection is doing, kind of that air, sea, and ground in terms of its approach. And these are the watches, if you're looking at Citizen, that will get the most respect. And no one's going to knock the guy when wearing a Citizen. In terms of a dive watches and ProMasters, these are, I know, highly respected as well in their field. Now, next up is Bulova. And for Bulova, I would say the best watch, specific watch here, is gonna be the Lunar Pilot in terms of getting some respect. Now, this is a watch on the surface that I think is very much misunderstood. There is significant history behind this piece. Now, the Lunar Pilot is inspired by an actual moon watch design from Bulova back in the 1970s that was worn by Apollo astronaut David Scott in the Apollo 15 mission. He actually wore his specific prototype model on the moon's surface, which then sold at auction for $1.5 million. And this Lunar Pilot is the closest representation of that. You're getting a high frequency quartz movement, but the looks department, this thing just looks expensive. You got the history and the ties behind it and a design that really is, I would say, timeless. So this is certainly one that will get a ton of respect, and for south of $600, can't do much better if you're looking for a chronograph in this range with this amount of history. Now next we have Tissot. And just to keep it pretty general, because I think there's a ton of Tissot watches that could potentially be mentioned here. The Visidate as well as the Gentleman have now become, I would say, two of the most popular watches under $1,000 from Tissot, and great just entry doors into the world of Swiss watchmaking. So those are two choices. You can also go for the Lock, the Carson, the Belaid. Basically any Tissot automatic here is going to do the job. There are different levels of Tissot, kind of like you would look into the direction of Citizen, as I mentioned. You have more of the mall watch type of styles. And then you have, you know, these really serious entry-level Swiss watches that are a great entry door into this world. And that is really what I'm kind of putting at here. Tissot is a mass market brand, but for some specific models, the automatics, these can't really get any hate. Staying with Switzerland, and perhaps maybe the best option, singular option for an entry-level watch, for Switzerland, Hamilton. Now Hamilton, in terms of their history in developing military field watches, is incredibly rich. I've done some videos in the past reviewing many of their timepieces, and actually did a recent video looking at their Chrono H, which is gonna be more expensive, but the entry-level field watches from Hamilton are so difficult to beat. I do wanna mention CWC as another alternative for those that have an affinity to British military watches, so I will mention that as well. Hamilton, though, from a mass market perspective, I think does get a bit more emphasis and attention. And you're also getting the perks that come with being a member of the Swatch Group, 80-hour power reserve. You have the hand-wound versions. You also have the automatic versions. You can also look at something that's a little more outside the box with the Murph being a little bit larger, an interstellar watch. You also have the Pilot Pioneer, which is gonna have those classical dimensions, but essentially anything of the Khaki collection. I think the two that are gonna be the most standard are going to be the Khaki Field Mechanical as well as the Khaki Field Auto as being those entry doors. But even the highest end collectors, I see a ton of times, and that's including myself, just owning a Hamilton and just loving this brand and what they've really embodied for so long and still embody. Now, mechanical chronographs under $1,000, basically non-existent for the most part, especially if you're going for a column wheel chronograph that actually looks the part. But there is one, and that is the Seagull 1963. Now, this is a total enthusiast watch and what it's going for. Of course, using a Chinese movement inside of here, but that is not a bad thing, because if you actually look at this thing, This thing looks better than even a Valjoux 7750, which is going to be multiples and multiples of the price. Of course, just made in Switzerland. These movements are a pain to service, so you have to kind of look at it from that perspective. Are you really gonna spend the hundreds of dollars for servicing this watch if it only costs a few hundred bucks for the watch itself? You know, just keep that perspective. But in terms of actual respect, not gonna find a better value for money mechanical chronograph. And to that, it gets a ton of respect. All right, guys, well, that is my list of watches that even watch snobs can't hate. If you did enjoy the video, thumbs up, subscribe, and hit the bell icon. In addition, leave a comment. Which of these do you think is the most impervious to ever getting any hate? I'd love to see comments down below about that as well. In addition, definitely check out the new Citizen collection that we have now launched on our site, full authorized dealer of all Citizen watches, as well as 25 other brands at teddybaldestar.com. Makes all this content possible, quick and fast fulfillment, dedicated customer support, and factory warranty. So if something goes wrong, you're completely covered. Also, if you want to stay up to date with the content, we do have a couple places to stay up to date with. First being on Instagram, see some great photos of watches. And then on the other end, follow the additional channel that we have, which is our Teddy Baldestar Reviews channel. We'll be covering a few other watches there a week. So great place to go if you just love all things watches and just want to see some cool watches reviewed. But guys, thank you again so much for watching. Be well, and I will see you all very soon.